So I want to share with you how to tap into your trading superpowers. And it's something that I have been doing for years unconsciously. And as I'm going to share that with you, you will realize that you have been using that as well unconsciously in many areas of your life, but most probably not in your trading. So first, I need to let you know a general advice disclaimer. We need to do that here in Australia. And in a nutshell, I am not a psychologist. I'm a highly trained accredited coach. I have done accreditations in many different areas of coaching, like positive psychology coaching, neuro-linguistic programming, hypnosis, etc. I do any course that I can find to improve my skills. And also, if there were any certifications in neuroscience, I would do that as well, but unfortunately that's not available as yet in coaching. I think that will come soon, because there's been so much advances in understanding how the brain works, and it's just been amazing with MRI scans, etc. So just a little bit about me. I don't want to waste too much time, because we only have an hour and I could talk about that topic for many hours. It was me last year on the balcony, at my mom's balcony. So I trade the decks. I coach. And if you want to know anything else, just check out my website or send me an email. I think that's all you need to do to know for now. What I really want to talk to you about is really the mental strategies that we can use to tap into our superpowers. And to start off with, I will share with you why it is so hard to be disciplined, and really give you context of why you have become the trader that you are today. And then the mental game strategies that you can apply to become the trader that you deeply in your heart truly know that you can be, but maybe not show as yet. So as you guys have seen, my website's High Performance Trading, and I call myself a performance coach, a mental game coach. And what does it mean? It matters, I can tell you. But what does it mean? It simply means that performance is that we are doing certain activities in order to create certain results. And so if we are underperforming, we are creating results that we don't want to achieve. We still create results, right? But the ones that we don't want. And if we are performing at our optimal performance, then we are creating results that we can consist, or then we show behaviors that create results that help us on a consistent level to perform on a certain level, so that we don't have those spikes in performance. So we do really, really well, and then we do really, really badly. That would be overperforming, right? But we want to be at an optimal level of performance. And for this to happen, we, of course, want to have the best version of us showing up. It doesn't mean that we are looking for perfection, right? So when I'm helping traders with their performance, I'm ultimately working within the 6 inches between my traders' ears to help them to get the most out of their capabilities that they already have, and then trying to help them improve their mental game. So we just look at the key elements that will help you to improve your trading. We don't need to be the perfect person who meditates every day. Now, if meditation helps you to improve your game, then of course you do that. But there's many traders like Linda Rushkin. Linda says she is not meditating. She even laughs at it. But so she doesn't need that, because she has certain traits that she displays already naturally, whereas other traders don't have these traits and meditation helps them, right? So it's really about what helps you personally, individually. And so what I then do is, when I see the capabilities you already display, then we look at proven mental game strategies that we maybe can see in other traders who are already successful, and look at how you can apply those mental game strategies in your trading, and give you new tools to help you get ready in the zone, or help you trade from this flow state. Why do I say that? Because since Mark Douglas wrote his book, Trading in the Zone, that has become like a, like a buzzword, trading in the zone. And what does it mean, trading the zone? So being in the zone is pretty much a a state of flow, right? So that's when every single ounce of your capabilities come flowing through you. And you're so engaged in the process that you don't hear anything, you have no inner chatter, the monkey mind is completely quiet, there's just intense focus. And you're not restricted by the whispers of thoughts and concerns and worries and fears of judgments and self-doubt. No, that's all not there. So you know when you're in the zone, when it's just calmness and quietness in your mind. That is a nice benchmark to have, because now you know when you have all this mental chatter going on, you're not in the zone. And the trick is to find a way to consistently get yourself back into the flow, back into the zone, anytime you sit down in front of your trading screens, and you can command yourself and demand of yourself to create that state. So when we look at the common fears that traders experience, right, the looking stupid, they feel that traders, you know, the market took my money, that's not fair, and then they start revenge trading. So all these experiences that you read here on the screen, these are experiences that I have discussed with my traders, right? So for example, why is it that you don't want to take this trade, right? What's the hesitation all about? And when we dive deep and we explore, it comes down to, I'm just really afraid of looking stupid in front of my partner, in front of my friends. And that is really unconscious. It's not something that we consciously sit there and think, I'm afraid to look stupid. No, the conscious experience is, I'm hesitating, I'm afraid of taking that trade. Right? So it's the same with the revenge trading. It's not that we consciously think, oh, this is not fair that the market took my money. It is that unconsciously, it's on a conscious level that you start putting more and more trades on, trying to get your money back. And then when we dig deep and look at the unconscious level and what's driving that behavior, it's the sense of fairness or experiencing that it's not fair, right? So all these common fears that are listed here are pretty much experiences that traders bring to the surface level that they weren't aware of at the beginning. And that once they're on the conscious level, once they're on the table, now we can start working with them. So if you're not trading from your flow state, these are the common fears that you experience, right? So that's how you know. You're constantly fighting yourself and you're fighting your bad habits. And a common remedy that is being suggested is use your willpower. But now it's been proven with so many MRI scans and so many amazing experiments with high performers, not only in trading, but in sports, in business, that willpower is just not the solution. It's something that helps us momentarily to maybe get on top of a behavior, but it's not transforming us at our core. And what I'm talking to you about today is helping you to have a transformation that is at our core. And these fears, you know, that you see, that you experienced yourself, they are really the hidden forces that keep tripping us over and that keep keeping us trapped. Now, I believe Ed Sekoda was wrong. Ed Sekoda said, win or lose, everybody gets what they want out of the market. Some people seem to like to lose, so they win by losing money. And I hear what he's saying, right? So the concept I agree with, but it's not the what we experience in the markets that is the way we are, right? So that's what he said. It's what you experience in the market is the way you are. It's actually the way your what we call roles are. So roles are simply a programming that we have learned from our environment, from our parents, from experiences, like, you know, many people have been sick at an early age, right? Maybe had cancer or had some traumatic experiences or lost a loved one at an early age. These are the programmings that happen deep on a deep level, right? It's already so common, everybody talks about it, so you understand what I'm talking about here, I just assume that. Now, these roles that we take on in life are often behaviors that were created by being rewarded with love and attention, or were not accepted in the family were being punished. So this is how we have been trained to behave a certain way. And that's the programming that's creating the what I call the role we took on in life. And that's pretty much Carl Jung's work and John Bradshaw's work. That's where it started. So if you find the markets, for example, overwhelming and scary, it's not you, it's the role that you took on and that's acting out. Now, if you are someone who is overly aggressive in the markets, it's not you, it's the role that you're acting out. And if you are someone who hesitates to take a trade and seeks perfection, you know, again, I ask myself, where did you learn this perfectionist behavior from? And then when we know how you learned it, then we can unlearn it. And my job is then to help you learn a new behavior and replace that old behavior that serves you, that helps you to create the results that you are seeking. So those roles are really hidden subconscious forces that are like the masks of inadequacy, the mask of feeling that we don't matter if we don't perform well. That goes into self-loathing, right? When we feel we are unworthy, we have to prove ourselves. Or when we feel powerless that, you know, I'm working so hard and yet I'm not successful yet, and we feel that we are doomed, right? This victimhood. All these experiences are the masks, are the roles. And so when the traders perform, improve their performance and grow and become better traders, and I'm not talking about developing the skill of trading, of course, that's a separate conversation. I'm solely talking about mindset. So how do you know that mindset is an issue for you? Let me just clarify that for you. When you give yourself the challenge of putting on trades and regardless of what happens, regardless of the chatter in your mind, you say, I take a loss at 0.5% of my capital. Let's say you take a $100 loss. And if you can take that $100 loss anytime, no matter how you feel about it, no matter how much inner self-talk you have that's disempowering, you still take that loss, then you're good on the mindset level. You just need to focus on your skills level. But the reality is that most traders can't do that on a consistent level. The reality is that if they would take their losses, then they wouldn't need to worry about it. Their inability to take that loss anytime, every time at that 0.5% or 1% or whichever level you give yourself, that is the role that you're that is causing that behavior. So it's not that you're changing when you are becoming a better trader. It's that the masks, the roles fall off. You get back to who you truly are at your core. Because, you know, when we are born whole, vulnerable, resilient, strong-minded. You know, the people, you guys of you who have children know what I'm talking about. easy expressing a whole range of emotions, going from happiness into anger in a split second and back to joy. Being courageous, risk-taking, creative, playful, loving, spontaneous, curious, intuitive, all these traits is what we are born with. And if we had those traits in trading, if we were to display those traits in trading, that would help us to succeed so much faster. I think Brett Steinbacher in his recent interview with Rolf from Tradesite, he said that curiosity is the number one trait that he sees in successful traders that they all have in common. Now, if your curiosity was squashed when you grew up, you will be afraid of making mistakes, or you will be afraid of being curious. It could be something simple as when, you know, how little kids, I think at the age of 2, they go through the why stage. Why is that? Why do I have to do that? And especially when they go to the teenage stage, right? So the kids say, why do I have to go to bed early? Why do I have to go to school? Why can't I have this? And the common answer is, well, because I'm your mom and I told you so, or because your father said so. There is no context given. And so that is then curiosity being squashed. Yeah. And we all take as granted that our parents did not fuck us up on purpose. Okay. They all did the best that they could. And there's no judgment of our parents. It's simply having a look at where did we learn that behavior? How did we learn it? And how can we unlearn it and replace it with a more powerful behavior? So when we are born with our true self, And then something happens, right? So what I just explained, our curiosity got squashed, or we were asking for help as a child, but we were being ridiculed. And then it's what we call toxic shame in coaching. Your toxic shame, the bits that we don't want anyone to see, that we feel ashamed of, or feel guilty of, anything that we feel we need to apologize for or hide or pretend it's there and there that is not there by pretending we are someone else, right? So it's always said that bullies who bully children are the ones who have been hurt the most, and they're trying to mask that hurt them, to mask how they feel so bad about themselves by attacking others. So putting the focus onto others rather than themselves. And so that would then create a role. The role is then the guardian that we show, we display to the outer world, that we are not being found out what our uglies are. And the uglies are not uglies. That's just how we have been brought up as. And so we create those stories that we tell ourselves, this narrative of why we can't be successful or why we have to be successful at any cost. And these roles are solely designed to protect us, nothing else. So when you have a narrative about why you can do what you do or why you cannot do what we do, so those stories that we tell ourselves, we are subconsciously always receiving messages from the inside, from our inner voice. And because of the harsh way we judge our own efforts, we try to keep safe rather than play the game to win it. In addition to the messages we are telling ourselves, we are also interpreting the judgments that we think other people place on us. But really, they are judgments that these people that judge us place on themselves, right? So it's the saying where we, I think it was Dr. John DeMartini who said, what you think of me is none of my business. It's all about you. And what I think about you is none of your business. It's all about me, right? I love that. It's so freeing. So the reason why the roles create those inner resistances that stop us achieving our goals and dreams as adults, you know, are as a protective mechanism. And if we don't, it's a protective mechanism that actually creates the very pain that we don't want to have, because they protected us as kids, but they don't protect us as adults, right? And so if we don't find other ways to navigate these subconscious forces, they're hidden, they keep us trapped. So what we need to learn is we need to look at narratives that we can learn from people who have achieved the goals and the dreams that we want to have, that they already live, and so that we can model them and borrow from them the strengths that we think we don't have, but that we actually just simply can't see. So example of roles are being the victim, so always blaming, not taking responsibility. You know, it was because my mother never let me grow up, and so I have become dependent. You know, the hero who has perfectionism, the designated patient who is always ill and out of control. So there's these roles that people like Carl Jung and John Bradshaw have identified that people play in family dynamics, and they only play them because, as I said before, they have been trained to play those behaviors. So if you have someone who is the good girl or the good boy, it's because they were always being rewarded for being nice and sweet and good, but they were being punished for being successful and being assertive and wanting to be independent. That was not allowed. Right. So again, there is no right or wrong. Each role has something that works for us, that makes us help succeed in life. And in other areas of life, it helps us to royally screw up. So we keep the parts of the role that help us be our best, and we add new areas to our role that we need to improve on. So for example, when we have a lost child, so that is someone with a low self-esteem because they're constantly have been put down, or they always have been told that they can't do it, that they're not good enough, that they don't have what it takes. They can learn from the hero who has an overinflated level of can-do-ness, you know, of they're feeling so capable. And these are the traders who naturally become successful, who are like, what is this whole trading mindset thing all about anyway? That's a complete, we don't need that. That's because I don't understand what it feels like to feel incapable. What's really interesting was talking with a friend who is one of those heroes. She's a high achiever. She, you know, she's a one of the, I think she's director at Deloitte in the US. And she she's just, you know, one of those can-do women. And so something happened in her life on a personal level. And she had to do an assessment for work where they're being assessed once a year. And she said she was sitting there in the assessment, which was normal, which was done under pressure. So she had to perform a mathematical task under pressure that she has performed many, many times before, never any problem. So when she gets put under pressure, she has the canny ability to just focus. She goes into focus, she blends everything out. But because of that thing that happened in her personal life, her mind went blank. It fogged up. She could not think. And out of 12 questions, she could only answer 4. So the first time she experienced what it's like to be in the role of a lost child. And that was so interesting to me. And she started having more compassion for people who underperform, who don't perform the level that she does. And this is what traders experience, right? They get into a trade, the trade doesn't work out, the market moves hard and fast like it did last night, or, you know, your today in America, our last night here in Australia. And then you freeze, right? You paralyze, your mind goes blank. And so that's what I'm saying, in those moments, amongst doing many other improvements and finding out, you know, how to add more tools into your toolbox and transform some behavioral patterns, you can then tap into how the hero thinks, how the hero deals with stress and challenge and pressure. So that's how it works, because the roles sit at our level of identity. And unless you have actively worked and uncovered them, you don't even realize that you're acting through those roles. And so that's why now that you're aware of it, you can start tapping into what is it that I'm naturally doing that stops me from performing? What is this enemy in my head trying to keep me safe and keeps whispering to me all the time and stopping me to do what needs to be done, stopping me from taking my losses, stopping me to let my profits run, stopping me to get into the trade, right? These are the core drivers of your performance, or, you know, lack of performance most probably. Now, what you can do to transform that now is to tap into your, what I call the superconscious. And the superconscious is something that you can create for yourself, because if you're not making money right now in your trading, or you could make so much more, then the mind that you bring to your trading is not going to be the one that creates success in your trading. That means you have to consciously build a success mindset. And you can do that by expanding your mindset, by inviting what I call a trusted friend. And again, I've done that for many years unconsciously. I wasn't aware of it. And until I read what's his name? The Alter Ego book from Todd Herman. And it's like, yeah, I do that. Of course I do that all the time. And I would do that with my traders as well. So to give you an example, I was working with a trader in my group last week, and she has problems to focus. And then we looked at number one, why she has a problem to focus, and, you know, how we can transform that. But we don't want to wait until she has mastered being focused. We want to start helping her to develop the process of, in the strategy of being focused. And so she was looking at this, so she's Japanese background, and she looked at this this sumo wrestler who has this really intense focus that helps him to succeed. And she always looked at this, she felt drawn to this guy who is a sniper, who has done a lot of videos, and I forgot his name, unfortunately. He was a sniper, and he talks about how he succeeded as a sniper. And so we looked at how can she tap into his superpower of focus as a sniper and bring that into her own life. And how it all started for myself, so when I say life, I talk about trading, of course. How that started for me was many years ago in 2014, I think it was, I worked with quite a new trader who was a quite well-known actress here in Australia. She's not worldwide known, she's only here in Australia, because she played in Home and Away, which is just so much loved here in Australia. And so her name was Anna, and Anna lived close to where I lived, and we became friends. And so one day she came over to my place and she watched me trade. And then she looked at me in disbelief, right? I still remember, and she said, "I can't believe it. Like when you look, when you're trading, you're this completely different person." And she said, "I noticed you're completely different when you go into your coaching mindset, or when we are just out having fun and going partying and or meeting for a coffee." And so she immediately pointed out three different roles that I took on in each area of my life to perform at my best, to bring out the best that I needed in that context. Because to have fun when I'm going out partying with my friends, these are not traits that I could bring to my trading, right? So the traits that I have in my trading, the intense focus, the self-belief, the trust, the being calm and grounded, that's not fun to be around when I go out. And so when Anna shared that with me, I asked her, "So how do you do that as an actress? How do you become all these different personalities that you have to do when you're on stage?" So she's actually a lot into theater nowadays. She doesn't do much TV anymore. And she said she actually taps into other actors for that specific role. And it doesn't need to be male or female just because she's female. So she would, for example, tap into Raging Bull, I think it was Robert De Niro, when she needed to be really angry. Or she would tap into Cinderella when she needed to be, you know, lovely and sweet. And I thought, wow, this is so interesting. I can do that for myself too. And this is really when I started doing that actively and intentionally. Now, Todd Herman talks about, let me just go here. Todd Herman talks about Beyoncé creating Sasha Fierce on stage because she was so, she was so shy and, you know, going on stage that is so vulnerable, you know, you're being judged all the time and, you know, being attacked. So what actors do is they create this alter ego. I watched an documentary about Eminem. He created Slim Shady. And so when he was attacked, it was Slim Shady being attacked, not him. I think his real name is Matthew something. And so this is the M&M, Matthew M. And we can do the same in trading, right? So who do I have to be in that moment so that I can do what I need to do? Because when I started out, one of my biggest challenges was discipline, right? I have been brought up as a very free spirit. And being disciplined was not something that I easily displaced. I had to train myself all the time. Now, at the beginning, I always put myself down. You know, why am I not disciplined? Why is it so hard for me to get up in the morning at 5 o'clock to go to the gym? And I say I get up at 5 o'clock. Why is it so hard for me to keep the promises that I make? Why is it so hard for me to have integrity? Integrity meaning doing what I say I do and being who I say I do, right? So being what I say I do means, you know, in terms of I say I am a disciplined person, but then when I turned down the volume and only looked at my actions, I wasn't disciplined, right? So to give you an example, losing weight. So many people want to lose weight, not only females, also males. Now, they say they want to lose weight, but it's an aspirational value of wanting to lose weight, because if you turn down the volume, they don't do what needs to be done in order to lose weight. So consciously they want to, but unconsciously it's the role that keeps them stuck, that keeps them from doing the things that need to be done. Same in trading. If you're a trader who wants to be a $1 million trader, but you don't take your losses or you let opportunities pass by, then you have the aspirational value of wanting to be a successful trader, but you don't do what needs to be done because of that role that you took on. Now, if you consider that the roles that we have learned from our parents are kind of like taking on their powers, which were obviously not superpowers because they don't help us to succeed, and again, there's no judgment, right? If we look at the roles that we took on from our parents are simply something that we have learned, they are not our personality because personality is fixed. And research has shown that our behavior is around 40% genetic and 60% learned. That is really good news. That means that we can actually learn new roles. So how about we start consciously changing our roles? So if you had the role of, let's say, playing the good boy or the good girl, meaning that you were always being rewarded for being the sweet, good boy, making your mother look good, then you see yourself as a good person. You have to be a good person in order to feel good about yourself. And that's unconscious. Now, in trading, if that is a conflict, because you have heard that when you win, when you make profits, you take them from someone else, unconsciously you will sacrifice your success, your profits, because you don't want to be a bad person. Or to give you another example, I was working with a trader who, my God, he has so much talent, he has so much ability. He's very smart, he has IT background, but from a very young age, he helped his father in his business, and he helped his father build the business. And so he is now in his early 30s, he has his own family, and he wants to do for the first time in his life what makes him happy. And so his father has envisioned that he will take over his father's business, but he doesn't want to. He wants to be a full-time trader and just be a nomad and travel the world with his family. And his wife is on board, right? His wife wants to do that as well. The kids are still very, very small. Now, when we looked at why he had the self-sabotaging behavioral pattern, because his trading strategy worked, we tested it. And so what we did is I asked him to go on Live Market Replay, trade the last 5 years, and his system works. It's proven. So why did he sabotage himself? And what we uncovered, what we unearthed, what we brought into the sunlight was the inner conflict, the values conflict of knowing that he has to disappoint his father. Like, there's no questions asked. There's no way around. His father will be disappointed that he doesn't want to take over the family business, and there's no one else to take over the family business, right? So it would mean selling the business that he put in his blood, sweat, and tears. So this inner conflict was what caused him to sabotage his trading. And it is something that he couldn't figure out himself, but that we could figure out together, because you have to go so deep, you can't create that. So looking again at Sasha Fierce or Beyoncé, I realized that I needed to create mental toughness because I was not mental tough. I needed to create this fierceness, this grr, because naturally I'm not a fighter. Naturally, I'm not a warrior. Naturally, I'm more, I was being rewarded for being sweet and nice and making my mom look good. And I love my mom. We are laughing at this together. So everything that I'm sharing with you here, I have discussed with my mom first, of course, and she's completely cool. And so I needed to create this warrior in me. And so I would tap into Xena, the warrior princess, but I couldn't resonate with her. You know, and I tapped into several other, superwoman. I couldn't resonate with it. And then, you know, Goggins came, and I can resonate with Goggins because Goggins says he's fighting with himself all the time. And it's about doing what needs to be done no matter what. So it's about feeling bad and still doing that thing. I didn't need to become someone who loves taking losses. I could hate taking losses. I could hurt about having a loss and still do that thing that needs to be done. right? And this is what Goggins is all about. And I love that, right? That really, really helped me to tap into his superpower, because I didn't have that cultivated within myself as yet. That was like a seed that was inside of me. We all have the seed of discipline. We all have the seed of courage. We all have the seed of focus. We have that. But if it hasn't been cultivated, it lies dormant in the ground. And so when we tap into other people, that's how we can then cultivate that within ourselves as well. Yeah. We can learn to take on new roles, how actors do it, how we all did it when we played games as kids. And so I looked at someone who is super, super smart, so who's not necessarily the strongest or the fittest, but who, that's where the jujutsu, the martial arts comes in, because I saw an interview and they said, who would win? And I can't remember whom it was, such a shame. But they asked this person, who would win when you have different martial artists fight each other? Which martial arts would win? And he said, it's not the martial arts that wins. It's the one who has the strongest mind, who is the smartest, so who can think in advance, who has strategic thinking. And I thought, this is so interesting. That's the same with trading, because I have seen traders who, they take like the most simplest strategies. I have this guy in America who trades a simple reversal pattern outside Bollinger of a certain level, resistance or support level. And, he makes so much money with it. But he's smart about how he applies that simple tool. And then I have been working with traders who have like really difficult option strategies and condors and I don't know what. They're highly mathematical. They're super smart. And they also make a lot of money. So we say in coaching, that's what I actually say, in the hands of a healthy mind, any strategy will work. Right, so anyone who knows how to think, who is balanced in their emotions, who is who knows how to overcome obstacles, any strategy that I would give them, they can make successful. And on the flip side, anyone who has those disempowering roles of a lost child, of a scapegoat, of good boy or good girl, no matter what strategy you give them, they won't be able to succeed. And so that's why it is so important that you first find out what are the behavioral patterns that you have been taught growing up that now don't help you to succeed in your trading. And then tap into the people who already do the difficult things and look at how do they do that? How do they think? And then reprogram yourself like you were programmed when you were a child. It's exactly the same process. But instead of having someone else rewarding you or punishing you, you do that for yourself. So when you take your loss earlier than you did last time, and it doesn't need to be perfect, right? So let's say you said, I take my loss at 0.5%. Even if you didn't take it at 0.5%, even if you took it at 1%, you still say, well done, I'm so proud of you. And you tap yourself on the shoulder. So you reward your good behaviors. And you do the same thing when you don't do what it takes. So for example, I was working with a trader and he is in his late 30s. He still hasn't grown up. He's still very childlike. And so because his mother kept him very dependent on him. He still lives with his mother, by the way. So first job for him is to move out. And the second job is, for example, we put in some rules. So he loves breaking rules. And I said to him, so how can you stop breaking a rule? And then he put on a new rule. He said, well, if I don't get up on time, which is 7 o'clock in the morning, in order to be prepared for trading, then I'm not allowed to trade. And I said, but you're running in circles because you love breaking rules. It's just another rule that you're going to break. And you're letting yourself off the hook, right? The same way your mother always let you off the hook. And you're letting yourself off the hook by giving yourself an out if you don't get up in the morning. the thing is, there is no if I don't get up in the morning. There is only I get up in the morning at 7 o'clock from Monday to Friday. So can you see the difference? Because Goggins doesn't say, if I don't go for my run, I cannot have my cucumber. No, he's like, I go for a run no matter what. Yeah, so this is how he thinks, and studying how he thinks, I can then take that on board and do that for myself. Right? So as long as you don't take action to better yourself, it is only an aspiration. As long as you keep a backdoor open, as long as you let yourself off the hook, it is only an aspirational goal, but you are not committed. You're only interested. And it's not a goal, it's a dream. But if you say, hey, I can do that. I can do it because he does or she does. And that's why I can do it too. And you draw into their natural abilities that you have lying dormant within yourself. And you're expanding your mindset as if you were to invite a trusted friend who has a superpower in that particular area that you're not performing so well in. So when you tap into that, it will help you to overcome the resistance in that area that you experience resistance. Again, if you look at the common mistakes that traders make, like, I don't have it here. So like not taking a loss, for example, that is an inner resistance that you then gracefully can overcome, that you can gracefully navigate. And you know, like in Aikido, you don't use force to combat force, right? This would be willpower when you try to force yourself to do that behavior that you don't display at the moment, aka pressing that mouse button. I mean, we all have the power to press a mouse button, right? But still, there's this overriding force that stops us doing it. But you can navigate yourself and navigate around that challenge by looking at how do I say that? So when you look at Goggins, that will invoke a certain feeling in you. And for some of you, Goggins will work, for others it won't. So you have to find your own role model that you want to model. For example, I love modeling Linda, as you guys know. Linda has this intense focus, and I had an experience with Linda where I was standing next to her and she completely didn't notice I was next to her. She was so focused on her trade. And I spoke to her, I said, here's your coffee, because I didn't notice that she was already in her trade. So it wasn't up to me having to be conscious of her being in that trade. She didn't need the outside world to respect her focus, to not disturb her when she is trading. She has covered herself. Because she has this intense focus within herself that she blends out everything around her. And I was listening to an interview with a race car driver this morning, and he said, the moment I put on my helmet, I don't see anything, I don't hear anything. It's just the car, the asphalt in front of me, and myself. And that's what we want to tap into. So every time when I need to tap into focus, I remember Linda because I felt her focus. And I could feel that. So the way we process information in our mind is by making mental images and by having emotional experiences. And by the way, this is also how we store memories, through the mental images and through the feelings that we experience. And so this is how we then can create with intention who we want to become as a trader, right? So we don't need to meet the resistance with force, but we can meet the resistance with wits, with being smart about it, with creative imagination, with grace, sidestepping the inner resistance rather than trying to break through it and forcing ourselves to do and be different, which is almost impossible, right? So in this place of this constant self-bullying, we can stop that and we can look at, so what's that seed that I have within myself, that my own best self that I want to bring out like a best friend, and then tap into that best friend. Another example that I used, again, unconsciously, was standards of excellence. Now, based on, again, how I was being brought up, I had very low standards of excellence, which then impacted any area of my life, and especially in trading. Now, in trading, I was motivated enough to change that. In other areas, I maybe was not motivated enough. And I'm like, I don't care, would rather be lazy than doing what needs to be done, getting the job done. For example, preparing for a meeting the next day when I was working for Siemens, I would not always be prepared, right? So my standard of excellence was really, really low. Whereas in trading or in my coaching with my presentation here with for you guys, for example, I made sure that this is completed last night. I don't cramp in the last minute, which I used to do in my previous life. I don't do that anymore. That's my standard of excellence. Now, that was reinforced when I studied Richard Madden, the actor who I saw first in Bodyguard, and I loved how I really loved his performance. And I looked at how did he become such a good actor. And he mentioned that he is always prepared. And it was actually opposite. He was interviewed and he said he hates working with certain actors because they're never prepared. They don't know their lines. And then the interviewer asked him, so how do you prepare? And he said, I always know my lines. And then when I know my lines by heart, then I can go into artistry. Then I can start being creative with my lines. I sit with the actor that I have to work with and we try to say the same sentence in many, many different ways. And we try to find out what is the most impactful way to say this one word. So that it's not the word that makes all the speaking. It's my facial expression. It's the micro expressions that make a really good actor, by the way. So that I understand so that the emotion that I'm experiencing is coming across. You can see in the movie Bodyguard, it's often that he grinds his teeth and then this muscle comes out on the side of his jaw. He tightens his jaw and that says so much. So for him, his standard of excellence, that's always what I keep in mind when I want to prepare. And I had other role models before that I modeled who always said, I'm prepared the day before. And I'm like, I want to be like her. And if I want to be like her, that means that I want to have attributes that she has. And that means that I need to find out how she thinks and feels about this behavior. And then I take her thinking and feeling into my beingness. So Linda, for example, she's like, I don't have no problem taking my losses. And so I feel into how does she feel about it, right? By the way, Linda Rushke, in case you wonder who I'm talking about, the market wizard. So then I tap into the emotions that she displayed when she said that. And it was on an interview that she said that as well. And I listened to it over and over and over again until it became part of me. Not her being part of me, but how she thinks and how she feels. And so when I'm like reluctant to take a loss, I have her inner her voice. I see her saying to me, so that's the mental image that I make. I see her saying, I have no problems taking a loss. Whereas in the past, the mental image was me feeling small and feeling helpless and, you know, this overwhelming thing of having to press that mouse button. So all the mental images that were implanted in me when I was little that now played out in my trading and were an internal force of resistance that kept me trapped. And so that's how I changed my internal images and also my self-talk and tap into the superpowers that I saw other people had that really resonated with me and then made them my own. So when we look at why we love movies so much and why we love stories so much, it's because we can tap into something that we can resonate with. And every time you see something in someone else that you admire, I want you to consider that this is something that you already have within you. That is just being laying dormant. It's not something that's outside of you. It's not something where you say, he is so disciplined, I could never do that. Because that's then the letting yourself off the hook. Where you say, he is so disciplined, I can do that too. How is he doing that? What can I tap into? And so that is then the bridge that we are building in our mind from who we used to display who we used to behave as into who stepping into who we truly are and who we want to be. So we create ourselves as that powerful trader who creates results, who makes profits, and who can confront the challenges and the obstacles along the way. Because what I see most traders do is they say, I don't want to have those challenges. I don't want to have those problems in my trading. Can you help me to not hurt? No, I can't help you to not hurt, but I can help you to press that mouse button even though it hurts. Yeah, and any athlete you talk, you hear talking, endurance runners, so I was working with a trader who is a marathon runner, and I asked him, how do you do that when you are running up a mountain and your muscles hurt and you want to give up? And he says, I never want to give up. Like, you know, that's a complete mind read. I thrive on that. I love it because I now know that I'm better than most people out there. And so he's clearly a hero in his roles that he's playing, but that serves him, right? And he's like, this pain feels so good because I know my muscles are growing. I'm like, wow. And so then I started running, you know, and I did the same. It's like, that pain is so good. I can do this. And there's this guy, his website is The Champion's Mind, and he's a coach for athletes for sprinters, I believe. And he did that experiment with them where they have to run around the arena and they have to say to themselves, it's all too hard. Oh my God, I'm hurting. I never can do that. So this kind of self-talk. And then compare that experience with the next round running around the arena and saying, I can totally do this. I love this pain. That makes me better than anyone else. This is my superpower. I'm totally going to beat you. I'm going to beat this. And then compare the experiences. And that's exactly the superpower that we all can tap into as well. And that's why I'm saying every successful trader had a dark past and every losing trader has a bright future. And though no one can go back and make a brand new start, but anyone can start from now and make a brand new end, because we now have already these experiences and these learnings that we brought from our past, and we can apply them in our present so that we can create a new future. So I hope that was helpful for you guys. I'm happy to answer questions. So any questions, guys? Anything that you want me to help you with? I purposefully left a few minutes. No questions.
Hey, Mandy, I think everybody is mesmerized and digesting about everything that you said tonight.
Okay.
I mean, literally, everything is not only that so interesting, but it is amazing and it's applicable, it's doable. It's all mindset.
Yeah, it is. And, you know, Anka was just talking to a trader who contacted me, and he has enormous problems with his relationship at the moment, most probably going through divorce with two little kids. But he also has, you know, clearly gaps in his trading. And he said to me, look, I think I wait with the mindset work. I just go with learning more about trading strategy. And I said to him, you see, the thing is, when you only focus on learning and improving your strategy, your mind is so muddled with all the stress that you're encountering through your personal challenges in life, you will never make it. You need to work on your strategy whilst you work through your challenges in your relationship and mm-hmm. find peace in what's happening. You know, there was what happened was there was, again, two little kids, I think 3 and 5, and there was betrayal. So his wife is having an affair, but she, you know, she clearly likes the other guy more than she likes him. And that's challenging, right?
Terrible.
And but there's also reality of life that happens.
Yeah.
And if we don't address those issues first, no matter, he can have the best strategy, he can be in your trading room, he will still find a way to screw it up.
Exactly.
Yeah. And so what then most traders do is they go and make it a reflection onto you rather than a reflection onto them.
Right. So, David has a question here. David Boyle has a question here. He said, could you talk a little bit more on how to spot those roles?
Yes. So I could say this is what I teach in my course, but if you give me a second, then I'm happy to go through with you on the roles. So let me see if I still have that. So when the roles, I love this topic so much because, guys, you know, we can all work on a superficial level, like help me to become more confident, help me to take my losses, blah, blah. Going deep and doing this work, the roles work, that is really where the transformation lies. That's like cutting straight to the chase. So when we are being brought up, we can go into two extremes. One is overperforming or overfunctioning. The other one is underperforming or underfunctioning. So the underfunctioning guys, they're experiencing life as overwhelming, as confusing, as hard. They're never enough. People are out there to get them. You can't trust anyone. You can't trust yourself. And on the outside world, they look spontaneous and fun-loving and warm. But it's really an expression of their feeling worthless. They have a lack of commitment to succeed because they can't trust themselves. And because they can't trust themselves and because they have this enormous need to be accepted and to be appreciated, they make promises that they can't keep. And that will screw them over and will help them, will keep them failing because they make a promise, they can't keep it. And then they reinforce that they can't trust themselves and that they fail everyone. Because what happened was when they grew up, they experienced that no one believed in them. That's what I said before. When parents say, come, let me help you with it. Let me give you money. Let me buy you a car. Let me buy you this. Let me pay for your holidays. That is unconsciously giving the child the experience that they're not enough. And so they don't believe in themselves because no one ever did. And they have to live up to the image of never being enough. Yeah. Then on the flip side, the other extreme is the guys who have superiority. They're the narcissists. Trading is challenging. I love challenges. I need to get on top of that. Or I'd rather die than failing at that. I know best, and they have their perfectionist controlling. They're very righteous. And, these are typically, I'm generalizing here, right? The typical hedge fund trader, and they have to be in that space in order to succeed. So they could learn to soften a bit, and the underperformer can tap into the superpowers that the overperforming guys have, right? So these are what we call the heroes. And for them, it was that everyone believed in them so much that they had to step up, usually the oldest one in the family dynamics, where they had to take on responsibilities like taking care of the kids, of the younger siblings, being treated as little adults already, right? So that is the two extremes that you can start looking at. Now, when we look at, can you see that new slide, Anka, just quickly?
Yes, we can. Yes.
Okay, cool. So the most common roles, and if you Google that, there's heaps on the net as well. Overfunctioning, underfunctioning is having deep feelings of shame for not having achieved a success in life, right? Feeling helpless is underfunctioning. That would be one of the roles of the lost child. Feeling judged all the time, that's the scapegoat, because you were the one who was being told that it's your fault that the family has so many problems and it's your fault that the mother's having a headache and so on. If you lack critical thinking and you're overly emotional, then you're under functioning. So what you need to do is don't suppress your emotions, but practice and learn critical thinking, because this is what was suppressed when you grew up. You were not allowed to think. You were allowed having your emotions, but you weren't allowed to think. Whereas the oldest children or the overachievers, they weren't allowed having their emotions and they can't deal with emotions, but they are critical thinkers and they do really well in trading, generally speaking. So you're over reliant on others and you often feel let down. So that's usually the lost child, the scapegoat. And then you have to learn to rely on yourself, to trust yourself and to not let yourself down to begin with. And not let others down by making promises that you can't keep. So, for example, a trader I was working with, he said, I said to him, please send me your statistics so we can go through your stats before the session and send it to me a day before. And also send me the mindset work that you wanted to talk. So he said to me, I want to talk to you about this challenge that I have in my marriage. And I said to him, email me beforehand what it is. He said, yes, no problem. I do it by tonight. And I had neither when we started the session. So I said to him, this is exactly what screws you over. You made two promises that you didn't keep, even though we already spoke about it. So that is someone who has not learned to take responsibility in your life. So people, we all have experienced trauma on some level. And what happens is when we experience that trauma, we froze in that moment of time. So for me, it was my parents separating, even though I didn't experience it as trauma. But looking at my behavioral patterns, you know, when I started this work, I was clearly frozen at 7 years old. And so he is clearly frozen at 5 years old. He has not learned how to grow up. So my job is to help him how to be responsible, because then I said to him, how are you responsible? And he said, I have no clue. I don't even know what it means. And I said, start with stopping to ask your mom for advice. Right, that's what children do. That's not what adults do. And in order to do that, you need to learn how to strategically think, how to solve problems. So you need to become solution focused and results oriented and learn how to solve problems. And he's like, I have no clue how to do. And I said, great. Now we can start doing that work. I can share with you and teach you how to do that. Yeah, I hope that answered your question. I only, you know, in those 5 minutes, how you find out what your challenges are, what your roles are. Again, if you Google, there's loads of it on the internet. So good. Now, a functional trader recognizes that we take instructions from a child. They have a healthy and strong sense of themselves, not triggered by other people around them. So that's what I shared with you, what Linda did. Like Linda did completely blend me out. That is healthy. She needed to focus. Nothing could disturb her. Rather than going off at me and saying, Mandy, you know, can't you see that I'm trading? Which, you know, I recognized really quickly, but in the first instant I didn't. And they don't over-dramatize, right? They say, okay, that's a challenge. You see that with COVID, there's so much drama going on. COVID is a challenge. Now is the time where we have to dig deep into our resourcefulness and find solutions on how to deal with it, rather than sitting there and waiting for others to solve our problems, right? So that's what you want to then move towards to. And when you have achieved those benchmarks that I have on the screen here, then you know you have created new roles. Cool? All right. On time, I made it. Thank you so much, everyone. I don't do any sales, as you know. You can go to my website if you
want. Yes, please, Mandy, if you can, just let me know what your website is so I can type it in right here. I know I had it at some point. Highperformancetrading.com. Okay, here it is. Yeah. I'm going to type it in.
Thank you so much. Fabulous. Now, it was a long day for you guys, and thanks, David. I hope you had an awesome day with such a fantastic lineup. And Anka, thank you so much, and David as well, for organizing the events. I know it takes a lot. It's a lot of work, guys. Please, show your gratitude to Anka and David. all the work that they put in to help make this, make our world of trading a better place, and help also to make the world a better place generally by helping traders to become financially independent, to become successful, to grow and become better versions of yourself. That's, you know, yeah, thank you for acknowledging